Okay, well, it's now my pleasure to address this topic of sleep disordered breathing, renal disease, and obesity, and in particular to sort of discuss or conclude with the question of, you know, which is the chicken and which is the egg here. And I'm really going to focus primarily for time's sake. You know, there's really too much here to cover in the time allotted. So I'm really going to focus on sleep disordered breathing, and of course, obesity is an associated risk factor for that in the setting of heart failure and cardiovascular disease. And I think one of the major reasons for that focus is really underscored by the data shown on this slide, which shows you that among the common comorbidities in heart failure, the most common is sleep disordered breathing, sleep apnea, whether that be of obstructive or primarily of central origin. And you can see that obesity is also highly prevalent in our heart failure patients at centers like ours, and I suspect some of yours that are engaged in cardiac transplantation. Obesity, BMI has become the number one exclusion from our transplant list. The average BMI of a heart failure patient in the U.S. today, based on registry and clinical trials data, is about 32. So on average, the heart failure population is not only overweight, it's frankly obese. And certainly this is a major problem and a major contributor to the high prevalence, particularly of obstructive sleep apnea in heart failure patients. So let's take a look at the prevalence of obstructive and central sleep apnea in heart failure patients. And consistent with the data shown on the prior slide, you can see that the overall prevalence of sleep apnea in the heart failure population is about 75%. Think about that, 75%, that means 3 out of every 4 of your heart failure patients has sleep disorder breathing, either predominantly obstructive sleep apnea or predominantly central sleep apnea, and in many cases, it's a mixture of both obstructive and central events. And you'll see that on average, this breaks down about 50-50. About 35 or 40% of our patients have mostly obstructive sleep apnea. The other half have mostly central sleep apnea. And we've learned over the past 4 or 5 decades that this is significant because it's associated with underlying mechanisms leading to heart failure disease progression and ultimately increased rates of morbidity and mortality. So if we start with obstructive or central sleep apnea, we know that this results in hypoxia, hypercapnia, diminished rest, largely due to increased arousals and an increase in arrhythmias. This results in certain neurohormonal and hemodynamic effects, particularly in sympathetic activation, effects on chemo and baroreceptors that further activate the deleterious sympathetic and renin-angiotensin systems. And that all feeds back into this vicious cycle and produces more obstructive and central sleep apneas. We know that the hypoxia worsens ischemia, inflammation, and neurohormonal activation, that the reduced sleep efficiency contributes to insulin resistance, fatigue, and poor exercise tolerance. The increased sympathetic drive causes atrial and ventricular arrhythmias and results in myocyte cell death and decreased cardiac function and increases blood pressure, thus increasing cardiac afterload. And as I mentioned, all of this sort of works together to increase morbidity and mortality in our heart failure patients. For example, mortality in patients who have heart failure and sleep apnea is 100% worse than those patients who have heart failure without sleep apnea. So there are now some emerging guidelines. This comes from the recently published ACCF AHA HFSA Heart Failure Guide guideline chaired by Clyde Yancey. And there are some newer recommendations in regard to sleep disordered breathing. You can see, first of all, there is a strong recommendation, a class 2A recommendation, that patients with symptomatic heart failure, class 2 through 4 heart failure, and suspicion of sleep disordered breathing or excessive daytime sleepiness should undergo a formal sleep assessment. And when you think about it, the symptoms, the suspicion of sleep disordered breathing or fatigue or tiredness or daytime sleepiness occurs in most of our symptomatic heart failure patients. So at Ohio State University, for example, we systematically screen 100% of our symptomatic heart failure patients for sleep disordered breathing. And that can be done now with pretty reliable and simple home testing devices rather than bringing everybody into the sleep lab. The guidelines go on to recommend, although the recommendation is somewhat weaker, a class 2B recommendation that in patients with cardiovascular disease and obstructive sleep apnea, CPAP may be reasonable to improve sleep quality and daytime sleepiness. There are no outcome studies here yet. So really, the use of CPAP for the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea in our heart failure patients is really intended to improve their symptoms and their quality of life, where studies have generally been positive. And there is now a class 3 recommendation indicating that the use of mask-based therapies, particularly adaptive servo-ventilation or ASV, is harmful for the treatment of central sleep apnea in heart failure patients. We'll come back to that in a few moments. So let's start with the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea in our heart failure patients. There are a variety of approaches that may be effective in the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea. The most effective of them is continuous positive airway pressure breathing, or CPAP. As long as you wear it, CPAP is highly effective for the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea. In some obese patients, weight loss may be effective at reducing the apnea hypopnea index. Some surgical procedures, particularly when the obstructive sleep apnea is less due to obesity and more related to anatomical considerations. Some folks who have, for example, small upper airway, large base of tongue, there are surgical procedures that may open up the airway and reduce some of the obstruction. And then there are emerging implantable devices that I'll talk a little bit about this morning. So first of all, CPAP creates an air splint for the upper airway. It is first-line therapy for the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea in general and also in heart failure patients. As mentioned, it is highly effective at reducing the apnea hypopnea index while being worn. The major challenge with CPAP is non-adherence rates continue to be a problem. And in most series or most studies, the non-adherence rate to CPAP ranges from anywhere from 20% to 60%. On average, after a month or two, only about 50% of patients are actually using their CPAP. It is at times a difficult or challenging therapy to tolerate, as is demonstrated by this patient example. So due to the pressure and the sense of claustrophobia and the fact that you've got this tubing laying all over you or around you at night, it really is not very well tolerated. Turns out that CPAP does not reduce, while it reduces the AHI, it doesn't reduce arousals. Patients still wake up frequently at night because they're dealing with all of this stuff. And so there really is a large need for alternatives to mask-based therapy. So I did, many of you know that I'm kind of a device guy. I get excited by devices, implantable and wearable devices that can treat human disease. And so there is now an FDA-approved device available for the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea. And it does that via hypoglossal nerve stimulation. It is a surgically implanted device with two leads that cause tongue protrusion by stimulation of the hypoglossal nerve, currently using a cuff electrode. So this is not yet a cardiologist device. This is generally implanted by ENT specialists or neurosurgeons because it requires the surgical implantation of a cuff electrode. But there are now, is under development a transvenous approach to delivering hypoglossal nerve stimulation. So this may be a device, maybe a procedure device that can be implanted by cardiac electrophysiologists or other cardiologists who have skill in transvenous electrode placement, essentially pacemaker or defibrillator placement, in the implantation of an implantable pulse generator. So on the horizon may be the ability to implant this device via a fully transvenous approach. The study enrolled patients who did not tolerate or accept CPAP therapy, and I'll tell you a little bit about that. The trial was called the STAR trial. This was published in 2014 in the New England Journal of Medicine. The characteristics of the patients are shown on this slide, and as you would expect, this was mostly an overweight or obese population. And one of the things that I do want to point out as we think about the application of this therapy to heart failure patients is that only very few heart failure patients were enrolled in this trial. This was predominantly a trial of OSA and not a trial of OSA in heart failure patients. But the results of the trial were positive and led to FDA approval of the device. It demonstrated a significant improvement in the apnea hypopnea index, a significant improvement in the oxygen desaturation index, and by responder analysis defined as at least a 50% reduction in the AHI to a value below 20 events per hour, about two-thirds of patients responded favorably to the therapy. So this is now available for consideration as a second-line therapy in patients who either don't tolerate or refuse to use CPAP for the treatment of their obstructive sleep apnea. Now, I think in heart failure, frankly, the more interesting form of sleep apnea is central sleep apnea, and this is where we get to the chicken or egg story here, because we tend to only see central sleep apnea in association with other disease syndromes, predominantly cardiovascular disease syndromes, including HFrEF, HFpEF, and atrial fibrillation. About 25% of AF patients have central sleep apnea, and it turns out they have a high recurrence rate of atrial fibrillation if that sleep apnea goes untreated. So there are multiple therapeutic modalities which have been attempted, have been evaluated for the treatment of central sleep apnea, including CPAP and a sort of advanced form of CPAP called adaptive servoventilation, which on a breath-by-breath basis, both during inspiration and expiration, provides exactly the right amount of positive airway pressure to keep the airway open. Turns out that that approach results in relatively high airway pressures in many patients in order to optimize the opening of the airway. It has been used in obstructive sleep apnea and has been studied in central sleep apnea, and I'll tell you more about that in just a moment. Oxygen therapy has been used for the treatment of central sleep apnea in heart failure patients, but has yet to be systematically studied in a large randomized controlled outcome study. That study may be coming. We have a current proposal pending at the NHLBI to do a nearly 1,000 patient randomized controlled trial of nocturnal oxygen therapy for the treatment of central sleep apnea in heart failure patients. And then there are certain medications which seem to be able to stimulate respiration and reduce the AHI, but most of these are drugs such as theophylline, which may be proarrhythmic and aren't used with much frequency in the heart failure population. So unfortunately, none of these have proven to be safe and effective, and some appear to be harmful, and that's why there's this class 3 recommendation against the use of ASV in heart failure patients. And many of you may be familiar with this study, but the study is called the SERVE-HF trial. It was published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2015, and it demonstrated that ASV was of no benefit in reducing the combined endpoint of cardiovascular death and heart failure hospitalization. And when death alone was analyzed in this study, there was actually a significant increase in mortality associated with adaptive servoventilation with a form of positive airway pressure breathing in heart failure patients with central sleep apnea. Now, why might that have occurred? Well, there are three main theories as to why positive airway pressure breathing might be deleterious in the setting of heart failure. First, some have speculated, but this has been largely discredited now, that CSA in the form of Chain-Stokes respiration is a compensatory mechanism in the setting of heart failure. Doesn't seem to be the case. The underlying pathophysiology is worsened and the mortality rates are substantially increased in patients that have CSA or CSR and heart failure. Another theory is that positive pressure delivered by ASV was harmful, particularly to hemodynamics. And another theory goes that the intermittent use was harmful, some sort of withdrawal syndrome, because it turns out in the SERVE-HF trial, the adherence to the therapy was only about 60%. Some patients wore it intermittently, and some have speculated that a withdrawal sort of syndrome might have led to harm. But really, the leading hypothesis here is the hemodynamic one, and here's the way this goes. In normal breathing works through the creation of negative intrathoracic pressure. The diaphragm pulls air into the lungs through the creation of negative intrathoracic pressure, and this actually has a variety of hemodynamic benefits, particularly enhancing venous return to the heart and improving preload and cardiac output. Mass-based therapies, positive airway pressure therapies, in that case, ventilation pushes air into the lungs via positive pressure, so the intrathoracic pressure is less negative or becomes positive, and this can result in a variety of unwanted hemodynamic effects. It impairs venous return, it increases pulmonary vascular resistance, it reduces cardiac output, and this may be especially problematic in low EF, low cardiac output heart failure patients. And all of these deleterious hemodynamic effects have been demonstrated in studies of mass-based therapies, positive airway pressure therapy. And you may have seen this. I saw this last week in our coronary care unit, a very sick heart failure patient in our coronary care unit with a marginal blood pressure. And when the positive airway pressure was turned on, the cardiac output and blood pressure fell substantially. So we've seen this at the bedside, and it's been proven in clinical study. So this leads me now to an emerging alternative for the treatment of central sleep apnea in heart failure patients, and that's via phrenic nerve stimulation for central sleep apnea. This is currently an investigational device, but it is under consideration for approval at the FDA. And if things go well, we may see this device available for use in our patients by perhaps as early as the end of this summer. So I thought this was something that you should know about or should hear about because this may enter clinical practice later this year. And this is, in fact, a cardiologist device because it is implanted using a transvenous approach. So if you're an electrophysiologist or a cardiologist and again have that skill for, you know, transvascular, transvenous device implantation, if you've implanted pacemakers or defibrillators or CRT devices, you can implant this device. So the device provides transvenous unilateral stimulation of the phrenic nerve. It does that through the implantation of a pulse generator and a lead. The lead goes onto either one side or the other and goes into a vessel which lies along the course of the phrenic nerve and through that can provide stimulation of the phrenic nerve and move the diaphragm. It treats patients automatically and continuously throughout the entire night and requires no patient adherence. There's a very sophisticated algorithm in the device. You set the timing when the patient, generally goes to sleep. It waits until certain parameters are met. The patient's in a recumbent position. They're generally still. It operates or activates automatically after that and treats throughout the night. If the patient wakes up, for example, to urinate, it shuts off, and then the algorithm turns it back on when the patient lays down and resumes the sleep parameters. So there's no patient adherence at play here, like mass-based therapies. As I mentioned, it's implanted by cardiologists experienced with implantable devices, and it generates negative pressure. It essentially restores a physiological breathing pattern, which augments cardiac preload without decreasing cardiac output. So if we come back to the scheme that I showed earlier, you can see that this phrenic nerve stimulation system really mimics normal breathing. It restores normal breathing. And the way that it does this is through continuous pacing of the diaphragm to normalize breathing rather than waiting until an apnea occurs. So the idea here is to entrain the system, entrain the diaphragm to breathe in a normal pattern and to avoid the hyperventilation, hypoventilation, apnea syndrome of Chain-Stokes respiration. Well, does it work? Here is one of the earliest studies that we did with this. This is a single patient example just to show you the dramatic on-off effect or off-on effect of phrenic nerve stimulation for CSA. So what you see on the left side of the tracing is the absolute typical periodic pattern of Chain-Stokes respiration, hyperventilation alternating with apnea. You can see that the moment that the therapy is turned on, this pattern of respiration completely disappears and respiration is normalized. In a series of studies leading up to a pivotal trial, from first-in-man assessment of safety and feasibility to a nearly 50-patient pilot study, the preliminary safety and efficacy of this approach was demonstrated, and a more than 90% reduction in the central apnea index was observed. A larger pivotal trial was done, and this was published last year in The Lancet. For time's sake, I won't take you through the individual data. I'll summarize it for you. But if you really want to dig deeply into this, this is the key paper to see from Maria Rosa Costanza. But the phrenic nerve stimulation system was demonstrated to produce tangible and statistically significant and clinically meaningful reductions in the apnea-hypopnea index, reductions of more than 50%. It reduced hypoxia dramatically. It improved sleep quality. And in contrast to mass-based therapies, there was a significant reduction in arousals as well. The sleep architecture was markedly improved. Patients slept better. This resulted in marked improvements in quality of life, as were demonstrated by patient global assessment, the Epworth Sleepiness Scale, and the Minnesota Living with Heart Failure Quality of Life score, a heart failure disease-specific quality of life assessment. So patients felt better. There was a very strong safety profile. The safety profile looked similar to a pacemaker. The data was consistent across all studies, and as mentioned, treated patients throughout the entire night. So let's conclude. This is my last slide that gets to the chicken or egg question. What really is the chicken and the egg here? And now I'm going to expand on what I showed you earlier and demonstrate that there really are two vicious cycles at play here, and they're interrelated, they're intertwined. The vicious cycle of sleep apnea, here particularly or specifically central sleep apnea, and the vicious cycle of heart failure, which work to amplify one another. So heart failure leads to central sleep apnea, and central sleep apnea leads to heart failure, and the two vicious cycles amplify one another. And if we're going to optimize outcomes in our heart failure patients, we have to treat both of these vicious cycles in heart failure, the central sleep apnea, as well as optimizing treatment of the heart failure. Thanks for your attention.